It is not just our patients, but also doctors first and foremost, who need to be healthy to look after their patients. So I wish you all have a very long and healthy life. And as we all know, the theme for this World Health Day is vector-borne diseases, the phrase being small bite, big threat. And Dr. V.G. Ramachandran will be delivering a lecture on this theme. So it is good to remember that World Health Day is celebrated on 7th April to mark the anniversary of the founding of the World Health Organization as a part of UNO. And this was established in 1948. And this day is a global campaign because it allows everyone from global leaders to the public in all countries to focus on a single health challenge that is identified each year and to hold promotional activities in this particular theme. And it also provides an opportunity to start some collective action so that we can all find solutions to health problems that can be of benefit to all of us. My talk is on expanding definitions of health. And as we all know that WHO has defined health in 1948, but these definitions have now been evolving over the last few years. So the main kind of definitions, one is the medical model which defines health. This was what was prevalent in the early expansion of the allopathic medicine in the early 20th century. And this essentially viewed body as a machine which was to be fixed when it was broken. And this definition of health was basically an absence of disease. So it viewed the body as a machine and it concerned itself with health problems. So if there was a disease, you had to treat it. If there was an impairment, you had to treat it. But this definition de-emphasizes the preventive aspect of health or preventive aspect of the medical care that is now considered very important. Then came the holistic model of health definition. And this was defined as state of complete well-being. But the problem was that it is difficult to define well-being, it is difficult to measure well-being, and there is essentially an element of subjectiveness even when you have measures to define or measure the well-being. And then is the wellness model which is now accepted. So the WHO definition which was given in 1948 when it was established was that health is a complete state of physical, mental and social well-being and not merely absence of illness. This was a holistic definition, and as per this expansive definition, health is not just the responsibility of the traditional health sector that we understand by doctors, hospitals, healthcare providers, but all sectors, institutions and organizations that influence the well-being of individuals and communities. So it is as much a responsibility of the people who work in the waterworks department to provide safe cleaning water and ensure good health as it is of the traditional health sector. But the criticism for this definition was that it is, as I said, it is difficult to measure well-being. There are some scales given to measure well-being, but these are essentially subjective. So there'll be a subjectiveness when you are measuring this kind of well-being and trying to compare the well-being of one community to another. There is this idea of complete well-being is something that is idealistic in nature, and this definition also implies the view that health is static throughout life, whereas it is a dynamic thing. You are trying to achieve greater health, so it is not something that one person is healthy throughout life and the other is not. So now there was something called the Ottawa Charter for Health Promotion, which was a part of WHO. This was in 1986, and this defined the health as the extent to which, this is a very expansive definition, and this is the extent to which an individual or group is able to realize aspirations and satisfy needs and to change or cope with the environment. So the idea that was promoted was that health is a resource for everyday life, not the objective of living. It is a positive concept that emphasizes social and personal responsibility resources as well as personal capacities. So essentially, health is viewed as a positive resource which will allow every individual to meet their full potential, to meet their aspirations, to fulfill their basic requirements in life. And this was essentially, the charter was to promote activities of health promotion. So the Ottawa Charter had activities to for health promotion, to find have better public policies relating to health, and to review the health sector or health services that were available. So this definition of health that is very expansive, it provides the foundation for developing the concept of health promotion. And first time in the Ottawa Charter, the health promotion was defined as the process of enabling people to increase control over and to improve their health. So now there is more of a movement to empower people and patients and populations themselves to promote healthy lifestyles so that they have control over their own health. And this is the goal of the health promotion activities that are organized and coordinated by the WHO. But is it possible to have a standard or a universal definition of health? Defining health is difficult. It may mean different things to different people, just like when we talk of stress or happiness, it means different things to different people. So it is not something that means the same thing to everybody. However, these definitions are important to define health when we use the terms such as health visitor, healthy education, and health promotion. Now, there was this author by the name of Kalnan who published a book on health and wellness, and he asked quite a large number of population in the UK setting as to what they meant by health. And these were the options given. And there is clearly a difference between the so-called upper middle class versus the working class as to what they consider by health. So while for the working class, getting through the day and not being ill is what they understand by health, which are the older definitions. For the upper middle class, it means a whole lot of other things. They need to be active, which was the major response. They also wanted to feel fit, feel strong, have a positive state of mind, able to cope with problems, having plenty of exercise and not being overweight. And none of these was a concern with the working class. So essentially, as we all know that we now have a different kind of diseases, the infectious diseases, which were a scourge of the past century, which still afflict the lower socioeconomic status, and the emerging definitions of affluence, like the lifestyle related diseases. The same goes for the concept that people have about health. And this is important for us to remember as doctors when we treat with different kind of patients. So what is the importance of understanding all this? It provides us one, an insight into the kind of patient that we are dealing with and what are their expectations out of the health sector. It also provides us with the foundation to design our health promotion materials depending on which is the kind of population that we are targeting. It also helps the informal care because we need to provide the ancillary care to the patient along with our drugs and surgeries. And depending on what the patients want, our informal care can be tailor-made. And of course, as doctors, we need to provide what the doctors, what the patients want depending on the background that they come from. Similarly, the older mechanism of diseases was simple. We had host, we had agent, we had environment, and this was the disease triangle that we all studied, and this resulted in disease. However, now even these concepts are evolving. You have a huge number of determinants of health. There's something called the health field, which health field elements, which has been defined by a Lalonde document, and different factors have different roles to play in causation of disease. Like it is the human biology, that is the body, the genetic makeup and the susceptibility, etc., the environment around us, the healthcare organization also, whether you have good access to healthcare, whether the preventive healthcare in that society is good, will also determine your health status, and then lifestyle behaviors and risk factors, which also include the etiology of diseases. And all these together will determine the health status of an individual. So now it is not just a simple triangle. You have so many factors, and this is the, just like the definition of health is evolving, the definition of disease causation and the concept of disease causation is also evolving. So if health and disease are all multifaceted and multifactorial, how can patient management be different? And this is what is of relevance to us in our day-to-day practices. The relevance to doctors for these evolving and expansive definitions of health is the kind of health campaign and health promotion activities that we do. Also, when we are managing patients, not just treating, but actually managing our patients, that these expansive definitions we need to keep in mind. And also physicians' own health, we must remember these expansive definitions. So when it comes to health campaigns or health promotion activities, it is not just doctors, but also social workers, educationists, spiritual leaders, who also contribute to the health of society and treat diseases. And all of these also need to fulfill their role, and it is not just the responsibility of the doctors. And our campaigns need to be multifaceted and appropriate to the population group that we are targeting. Then comes the day-to-day activity that we are all dealing with, that is the patient management, and where does all these expansive definitions of health fit? Some people may think that when we have so much disease to treat and we have so many patients to treat, why should physicians concern themselves with these kind of spiritual definitions of wellness, etc.? But we all know, we have all studied preventive and social medicine, at least counseling and educating on diet and exercise, they promote wellness and resiliency. They also promote better recovery from diseases and surgeries. And these are part of normal practice. And if they are not part of normal practice, they should be part of normal practice to promote better outcomes in diseases. So the things that we need to remember is that we need to understand the patient as a whole. There is a tendency for patient as a whole. There is a tendency for specialization and super specialization. But we need to understand the patient as a whole in context of a socio-economic environment. We also need to give appropriately targeted therapy. For example, it is good to have a standard protocol or the guidelines that are available now for every disease, but they cannot be strictly applied to each kind of population depending on the cost of therapy, the expectation of the patient, etc. We need to give appropriate therapy, and we need to have some concept of integrated medicine. However much we can, despite our busy schedules, there has to be integrated medicine in the sense that we also promote the other aspects of healthy well-being. And factors other than treatment will play a role in management for treating the patient as a whole. And also, now there is a revival of the family healthcare physician, at least among the affluent people. While among the in small towns, there is still the tendency that people want to go to the bigger specialist and the higher qualified person. They think they will get a better treatment. But like in Gurgaon, there is a whole revival of family health clinics, which are essentially the same concept that used to be earlier, that there is a doctor who knows everything about that family and everything about the medical history of that family and can give much more personalized and integrated care. So this is something that will eventually come back with the changing lifestyle of patients and populations. And then there is increasing trend. We see a lot of dissatisfaction among patients these days. There is also this sort of a cynicism between the patient and the doctor. So there are some things that were always taught to us, which we must remember, that a physician is obligated to consider more than a diseased organ, more even than the whole man. He must view the man in his world, which is when we can give an appropriately targeted therapy and have better patient satisfaction. And like somebody said, that in the sick room, 10 cents worth of human understanding equals $10 worth of medical science. This will also probably help in preventing the incidence of dissatisfaction and sometimes bordering on violence that happens in our day-to-day practices. So when we talk of management just beyond drug and surgical treatment, we must remember that the result of our treatment will depend upon the expectations, experience, and trust of the patient, which interacts with the confidence, trustworthiness, and personality of the healer. So all these things are important, and they will determine whether the patient actually feels satisfied and also whether the patient feels better. You may be giving absolutely the right treatment, the right drug, and have performed a perfect surgery, but whether the patient feels better will also depend on all these other factors. So nobody should underestimate the effect of kindness, encouraging words, and positive words to make the patient feel even better. And the most important thing for us in India is that our patients come from hugely diverse backgrounds with hugely different and expectations about what they expect from the doctor and what they mean by health, like we saw. So it is a challenge for us to provide them with the appropriate targeted therapy for each patient depending on his background. Then, like there is this holistic health, there is also a concept of holistic medicine. And while allopathic remedies have worked wonders and they have increased the lifespan over the last century, but we must also remember that sometimes it is important for the patient to just restore balance in their life, get adequate sleep, exercise, and good nutrition. And this is something we as doctors also need to promote. And this also holds true for doctors, because we all want to have healthy lifestyles. So we must remember that we, in our own lives also, we need to get adequate sleep, exercise, and good nutrition, and that not all alternative medicine is hocus pocus as we have traditionally believed. Then there is a trend of integrating our allopathic medicine with the what is called complementary and alternative medicine. The alternative medicine use is increasing worldwide, and it is probably because of over-specialization and a lack of true expert general physician in the allopathic system that people turn now to the complementary and alternative medicines. And there is a view that conventional medicine is increasingly expensive, depersonalized, and unable to cope with chronic stresses. So the challenge for the use for alternative medicines in India has always been there, and it is now probably undergoing a revival. The challenge for us as medically trained doctors is to be a little more receptive to the genuine forms of alternative medicine, but encourage only those practices which are scientific and established and stand to reason. And most important, beware of the false doctors or quacks that we have aplenty in our country. And like Plato said, the greatest mistake in the treatment of diseases is that there are physicians for the body and physicians for the soul, although the two cannot be separated. So in some way or the other, the complementary and alternative medicines, which provide not just treatment but also reassurance and a better spiritual health, needs to be promoted. Then This holistic medicine is also undergoing a lot of scientific studies. We actually have journals on complementary and alternative medicine which are published, which have scientific studies on these methods. For example, if we do a search in PubMed on yoga, it will lead more than 2,500 articles on yoga, and more than half of them deal with some sort of a study which studied the positive health benefits in specific disease conditions. And according to statistics, these kind of statistics are not available for India, but in US, which is considered to be the epicenter for the kind of medical practice that we follow, nearly 40% Americans use some form of complementary and alternative medicine. So this is something we need to integrate in some way with our entire medical system, not individually as doctors. It's not like we'll start prescribing yoga exercises or Ayurvedic medicines, but probably for those patients who have chronic diseases or have lifestyle issues, we need to encourage this as well so that they have a better lifestyle. And some people actually go further and argue that physicians themselves should advocate for improved work and environmental conditions, such as promoting walking and cycling rather than driving, and should advocate for policies that redistribute income. This is a huge field, of course. This is not for individual doctors, but as a lobby of doctors, as a group of doctors, possibly we need to work in this direction also. And then most importantly, there is a view that doctors are now handling a lot of stress because of the demanding nature of the profession and the increasing demands of the patients. So as a result of the lifestyle and the expectations, there's a high level of stress. And we must remember that to care for patients effectively, we must first care for ourselves. And all these concepts of health and the holistic health definitions, at least for ourselves, we can apply. And we must evolve work styles that are less stressful. So to conclude, with better healthcare in the last century, majority of the fatal infectious diseases of the last century are behind us. This is a huge achievement of the modern allopathic medicine, and nothing can take away from this achievement. And now the focus is on lifestyle-related chronic diseases, especially among the affluent people. So we need to understand the multifactorial nature of diseases, and not just diseases, but also the multifactorial nature of the patient management, that we need to go beyond drugs and surgeries and understand the patient as a whole and manage the patient as a whole. And this reduction in disease and mortality has not just come about from drugs, but also from better hygiene, sanitation, safe water, etc., which are all part of the complete definition of health. And while in India, the medical fraternity is providing very good high standard medical treatment comparable to almost anywhere in the world, but we still have a long way to go in the health sector organization, the basic infrastructure, equity, healthcare, and resources. And unless all this is done, the utopian ideal, or at least the ideal that all the population should have a basic level of health, cannot be met. This was something that Thomas Edison had said a long time ago, that the doctor of the future will no longer treat the human frame with drugs, but rather will cure and prevent disease with nutrition. We are not yet there. Possibly that will never be true, but we need to remember that these things will become more important, and we need to provide holistic healthcare. And probably, just like in many other fields, we have come a full circle, and the ideas of the past of a balanced lifestyle and alternative medicines, etc., will have a revival in the future. Thank you.